going to be like a quartet today. All right, Isaac. All right. I guess we'll go ahead and start with page 431. Good to see everybody this morning. All right, let's start with page 431. I love to tell the story of unseen things above, of Jesus and his glory, of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story because I know 'tis true. It satisfies my longing as nothing else can do. I love to tell the story, will be my theme and glory, to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story, more wonderful it seems than all the golden fancies of all our golden dreams. I love to tell the story, it did so much for me, and that is just the reason I tell it now to thee. I love to tell the story, 'twill be my theme and glory, to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story, 'tis pleasant to repeat what seems each time I tell it more wonderfully sweet. I love to tell the story, for some have never heard the message of salvation from God's own holy word. I love to tell the story, 'twill be my beam in glory, to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story, for those who know it best seem hungering and thirsting to hear it like the rest. And when in scenes of glory I sing the new, new song, 'twill be the old, old story that I have lived so long. I love to tell the story, 'twill be my theme in glory, to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love.
All right.
All right, good morning, everybody. I guess we ought to pray first. Lord, I ask you now in Jesus' precious name, God, to come meet with us, Lord, to be with us, Lord, in the front and the back and in all the different activities of the church, Lord, and all the like-minded churches around, Lord. And I ask you to just bless this time, Lord. We try to carve it out and make it special for you, Lord. You know, we try to hold this day to be for your worship and to learn about you here in Sunday school. And Lord, I pray that we'll pick up something this morning out of your book. And thank you again, Lord, and bless the preaching that's going to come after and this evening. And if you give us that day, Lord, and just thank you, Lord, for everything you do for us, the many blessings. In Jesus' precious name, amen. All right, so this lesson kind of is an offshoot. I really wanted to do a lesson on Handel's Messiah. I don't know if y'all ever heard that before, if you ever listened to it. It's beautiful, okay? But the words in it that they sing are important words, and they come straight out of your King James Bible. That's kind of why I wanted to do it. But to do it, I'd have to have somebody back in the sound room to play portions of it, and then I was going to teach on what those words meant. Thought that would be kind of neat, different, you know. But anyway, so that isn't going to happen. What I like about that Handel's Messiah, number one, is Handel, at the very end, he put SDG, Soli Deo Gloria, to glory alone, to God alone the glory. They said that it took him, I think, 24 days to write the whole music portion of that. And that's amazing when you consider that the music portion of that is over 2 hours long. And he did it in a 24-day period, or 24-day period. But anyway, it's like I said, it's beautiful. But let's see. I'll skip that part since I already messed it up. But the one thing, well, there's a lot of things, but according to science, one of the main things that makes us different than the animals is our ability to speak and communicate. And that also is tied in with what I was going to teach about this morning, which is music, which I really don't know a lot about other than I know what I like and what I don't like and that kind of thing. But, I mean, everybody does that. But that's the beauty of using the Bible. And I'm going to give you some illustrations as we move through here on how music affected people in the Bible. Okay, so that should settle, whether it's, good music or bad music, I guess. But I do need to say something from the start, because that way people don't think that I'm totally against music, because I'm not. I believe that music has its place in the church and in singing and that type of thing. But the problem is when it gets out of place, okay? When the church forgets, and I'm not saying that right now, this isn't directed right now, this is just a generalization, okay? But the main reason for church is to build people up and grow them in faith. The Bible says in Romans 10:17, it says, "So faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God." And then again in Hebrews 6, 11:6, it says, "But without faith it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him." So if music's put out of place in church and replaced by the Bible and by preaching, then there's something to matter. It's out of order. There was a quote, and I don't know how many of y'all are readers. I hope everybody is. First of your Bible. But there's other books by great, very good men that have written books and done extreme exploits for God. One of them's Hudson Taylor. I'd recommend reading his biography and things about him. Remember probably 30 years ago, I can't repeat them, but I got them written down in my Bible. I write a lot of things down in my Bible because I have my memory's short sometimes. But he had seven spiritual steps or things to follow that would keep you in right relationship with God. But out of that, one of the quotes that I remember is, he says, do not have your concert first, then tune your instruments afterwards. Begin the day with the Word of God and prayer, and get first of all into harmony with Him. So in other words, read your Bible, you hearing from God, and then you praying to God, you know, and talking to Him. And that's the way you remain in harmony with God, okay? And that's the only way, really, is that you remain in harmony. Now, some general references about music or instruments in the Bible. The first time it's mentioned in the Bible text is in Genesis 4:21. And in 4:21 it says, and his brother's name was Jubal. He was the father of all such that handle the harp and organ. And right, that's the first time it's mentioned, but chronologically, singing and music is mentioned before that. In Job, it's Job 38:7, where it talks about the angels are singing in heaven and worshiping God. It talks about the sons of God, the angels, before the world was formed. So, you know, so music has been here for a long time. So it's singing. And it's up in heaven, and men have down here have tried to copy it, I guess. The Bible only names 10 musical instruments. Five of them are mentioned in one particular passage. in Daniel chapter 3, the cornet. The cornet is there. Dulcimer, sackbut. The flute, those are all mentioned there. And I think that's the only time some of them are mentioned. There's also the cymbals mentioned in 2 Samuel 6:5, the timbrel in Exodus 15:20, the harp in Genesis 4:21, and of course the organ also. Psaltery is mentioned in 1 Samuel 10. 5, and the trumpets are mentioned in Numbers chapter 10, verses 1 through 10. And, of course, there's many other places, but I just want to give you an idea of at least one place where they're found. The Bible, to me, states pretty clearly, and if you just accept it the way it's written, that we've been here a little over 6,000 years, according to the Gentile calendar. Now, if you go by the Jewish calendar, we've been here 5,782 years. So, anyway, we've been here a long time. But according to your Bible, sometime around 2000 BC, which is over 4,000 years ago, music was already established on the earth, and that's when Genesis 4:21 is. And the interesting thing about 4:21 is, you know, you get the harp and the organ. Well, that's the harp is a stringed instrument, okay? That's the godfather of the piano, the dulcimer, the mandolins, the guitars, the bass, like Billy's bass, violin, harpsichords, all of them are stringed instruments. So it'd be like the grandfather of that. The organ, on the other hand, would be the grandfather of the wind instruments, the flutes, fifes, clarinets, oboes, ram's horn, trumpets, bugles, French horn, those kind of things. All back from the beginning of the Bible. First chapter, or first in the first book of the Bible. This is one thing too, and never really thought about it much, but spelling's very important, okay? And if you go into if you have a computer and you have a Bible search program on it, if you go in and type music, M U S I C, no, nothing will come up. Every time it's mentioned in the Bible, it's M U S I C K. Okay? And it shows up 16 times in your Bible and only once in the New Testament. So the other, well, of course, the other 15 are in the Old Testament. Jewish people have an amazing history of music, and it comes from, well, that whole Eastern culture over there is, they have a, I don't know what the right word is, a fascination with it, or I heard one thing on the radio just yesterday about how in the Eastern cultures, the weddings, when they do weddings, you have, it's not like a 1-2 hour, 3 hour ceremony like we do here. It's days, 2 days, 3 days of music, dancing, food, all of those things. Music is a lot more important in those cultures, I guess I should say. The Jewish people, like I said, have a rich history or a heritage in music. You know, you look at the Psalms. The Psalms are 150 different pieces of music, basically. They were all sung. They were all written in poem format. And that's, I don't know if you realize that. Like I said, I'm not a real big music guy, but most of these hymns in here weren't songs originally. They were written as poems. Then they were, a composer put words to them and changed them around a little bit. And they became the hymns we know today and sing all the time. Well, that's what the Psalms were. They were poems or songs that were all written down. And there's 150 of them. Of course, the longest one is Psalms 119, 176 verses, I believe. And that's all about the Word of God. So, again, that just shows you how important these things are. Many of the songs are about trials and troubles and triumph, tribulation, trials, and thanksgiving. I said trials twice because I wrote it twice, so that's why I said it. But, you know, some of them are prophetical when you look back to them. You know, like Psalms 22 is talking about Christ on the cross. Even though David wrote it back in, and David didn't have a clue about what he was even writing about, you know, but yet it was prophetical on him coming. So what the purpose of the class this morning is I'm going to give you like four examples, Lord willing, maybe a little bit more, but four examples of how music affects people for the good and the bad in your Bible. And hopefully by looking at those examples, and of course you can't spend a bunch of time on them, but I'm going to make some comments on them, but you can see a correlation of what good music is and what bad music is, all right? Let's see. All right, so, and like I said at the very beginning, is my opinion means very little, okay? I mean, it means a little bit to me, but contrawise, at least in my eyes, your opinion means very little too. should be the arbiter, and that's why I'm going to try to go to it and show you some examples out of it on, you know, what is good and what isn't good, okay? Because the Bible doesn't really sugarcoat stuff. But anyway, all right, so the first one's found in Samuel, and it's in 1 Samuel 16. We're going to start in verse 14. But this is, you know, this is where the saying, in my opinion, this is where the saying, music can cure the savage beast comes from. All right? But if you go on the internet, just like most of the stuff on the internet, it won't tell you the truth. It says that phrase, music will cure the savage cure or heal the savage beast came from a poem. It's a quote from a line in a play called The Mourning Bride. It was 1697. It was originally as music hath charms to soothe a savage beast. But again, you know, it's just anything that the world does is usually wrong, because this was in the Bible way before 1600s, okay? And, you know, a lot of things, you know, we use everyday words that are found in here, and we don't even know why we say them. I mean, we say stuff like stand up and face the music, or dance to the music. Those phrases are phrases that come out of situations that are in the Bible, and people don't even realize it. Anyway, all right. It just, like I said, is this where I say it or say it later? And a lot of this, you know, people, like I said, they don't understand they're using the Bible when they say stuff. The reason they don't is because they don't read the Bible. But they say it because they've read it maybe at some point. But this country, when it kicked the Bible out of school, I mean, the Bible used to be a textbook in school. I mean, instead of buying textbooks every year that changed and changed and changed, they would use the Bible to teach English, been a long time since they used to teach science, but still, this doesn't change unless man changes it, and then if he changes it, it's not worth 2 cents. But anyway, they kicked it out, and when they kicked it out, they lose their heritage. But if you, there's a couple of books out there, and I don't remember the names. I've mentioned them before about words we use every day and phrases we use every day that come straight out of the Bible, and yet people don't understand and know why they do it. They do it because they're quoting the only thing that's true is the Word of God. Anyway, all right. So back to the Bible. First one's 1 Samuel 16, verses 14 down through 23, but we're only going to read a few of the verses. It says, starting in 14, it says, "But the Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul, and an evil spirit from the Lord troubled him. And the servants of Saul said unto him, Behold, now an evil spirit from the God troubleth thee. Let our Lord now command thy servants, which are before thee, to seek out a man who is cunning, is a cunning player on a harp. And it shall come to pass, when the evil spirit from God is upon thee, that he shall play with his hand, and thou shalt be well." Okay, and then in verse 23 it says, "And it came to pass, when the evil spirit from God was upon Saul, and David took a harp and played it with his hand, so Saul was refreshed and was well, and the evil spirit departed from him." So music can have a calming effect on the evil spirits within a person. So without going into all the reasons that Saul hated David and tried to rage against him, it was a spiritual struggle within him. And the music can drive that out. Another example that we won't look at is found in 2 Kings 3:15. It says, "But now bring me a minstrel. And it came to pass, when the minstrel played, that the hand of the Lord came upon him." So music can, it'll affect you spiritually, but it can also heal you over time. And while I was, you know, and I'd rather say that after all my years of studying this and all this, but when I was working on this yesterday, I came across a song. I don't know if anybody's ever heard it, called a guy named Ray Bolts wrote it, "My Anchor Holds." Not in here, not the one that the anchor holds, but It's a song by that Ray Bolts recorded, and it's My Anchor Holds. And, you know, it's like so many of the hymns. And, again, going back to your hymn book, there's so many stories behind each one of these hymns in here. It's amazing how God would bring something to happen in a person's life, and it changes them and puts them in a place, and he writes a beautiful song. Well, the story behind it is that My Anchor Holds, the guy that actually wrote the song, it wasn't Ray Bolts, he recorded, he modified it and recorded it. It's a good song the way it is, but anyway, so this guy, he had lost his, all within a year, he lost his father. Him and his wife had a miscarriage, baby 16 months, I think. No, not 16 months, 16 weeks. And his wife had a lot of health problems also, all within a year's time. And he was a pastor of a church, and I don't know which kind, but doesn't matter. And he got his face shook, okay, because of that. And so he took what he called a sabbatical. He quit. and he was sitting down, and he was a piano player, and he kept playing this tune over and over and over again for days. Then he started putting words to it, and the song was called My Anchor Holds. And it was 12 minutes long, the song, when he got it done. And but his spiritual healing came from that song. And, you know, and then Ray Bolts heard the testimony, and then he bought the rights to it and made it shorter and changed it around. But it's just a story of how your life can be altered with music if it's the right kind, if it's good music. Let's see. I got a couple other things. This music from this harp wasn't, I wasn't there, but I'm assuming it wasn't like rock and roll, okay? It was soothing music. And it drove the evil spirits away. There's biblical proof in the of music that's good music, talked about in Ephesians 5:19 through 21. But 5:19 says, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things unto God the Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of God. Again, in Colossians 3:16, it says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms, hymns, spiritual songs, singing with grace in your heart to the Lord. So spiritual music should extol and lift up the Savior and God the Father. You know, none of the world's religions have songs written about their leader. And then I got to thinking about it, and there was one, okay? And I don't know how familiar y'all are or if you care, but there was a song by a guy named John Lennon, and he actually produced two different versions of it called My Sweet Lord. And in one of them, he's saying in the chorus, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. And then in the other version, he tells who his Lord is. He says, Krishna, Krishna, and Buddha, Buddha. And he's talking about that's who his sweet Lord is. Again, it's the world, and they're, you know, they reel the suckers in with the pretty song, just thinking about, well, he's singing about God. Well, he's singing about his God, little g. And, you know, anyway. The last thing is, notice in 3:16 that the order says admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. But before that it says, let the word of Christ dwell in you. There's other places in Scripture They talk about singing, and like I said, singing should be a part of your life, in my opinion anyway. And like I said, contrary to popular belief, I don't hate music. I love music, okay? But there's an example in Matthew 26:30 where it says, when right after the Lord's Supper, the disciples and the Lord, it says, and when they had sung a song, a hymn, they went out into the Mountain of Olives. So he was going to the garden, and he was singing on his way to the garden where he was going to face the, you know, that thing where he cried, drops of sweat, as sweat of great drops of blood. Paul and Barnabas is another example of singing. They were beaten, they were jailed, and what did they do? Acts 16:25. And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises to God, and the prisoners heard them. So, you know, they were ministering to themselves and with music. You know, the Christian should be able to praise God in any situation and sing praises to God in any situation. There's verses in Psalms 137, 1 through 4, about the children of Israel and when they went into captivity and they were under distress and they were being held captive in a strange land. It says, by the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down, yea, we wept when we remembered Zion. We hanged our harps on a willow in the midst thereof, for there they that carried us away required us a song, and they that wasted us required of us mirth, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion. And then they say, how shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? Well, Sound Doctrine made a song of that, which is a good song, by the way. You know, but yet, think about it as a Christian. You live in a strange land, okay? You ought to be able to sing, you know, in this land also. You know, we're just like they were subject to the laws of the land, we're subject to the laws of the land. Sometimes the laws of the land put you under distress. But, you know, it's up to you. Will you whine when you get under distress, or will you sing a song to God while you're under distress? You know, actually I have, will you whine and complain like spoiled children in my notes? So let me give you an example, some evil music. Talked about, we won't comment on it, we'll just give you the verse, Amos 5:21-24. It says, I hate and I despise your feast days. I will not smell your solemn assemblies. Though you offer me burnt offerings and meat offerings, I will not accept them. Neither will I regard the peace offerings of your fat of beast. Take thou away from me the noise of your songs, for I will not hear the melody of your vows. But let judgment run down as water and righteousness as a mighty stream. So these people are in idolatry. And, you know, they're still going through the trappings of worshiping God, but God knows their hearts, and God knows our hearts too, so you can't keep no secrets from God. I mean, you can come in here and fool me in a minute because I'm gullible, but you can't keep it from God. God knows what's going on and everything and anything. Anyway, second example, we need to move on. To me, this is akin to rock and roll. You know, if it isn't, it's a kissing cousin of it. This would be the world's music. This time it's, again, sung by people that are supposed to be God's people in the book of Exodus. The children of Israel have just come out of bondage in Egypt, and they're going across, they're getting ready to go to the promised land, and this thing happens, and it's amazing, you know. And you can't tell me that the Bible doesn't show people's character, just people in general's character. When you go to Exodus 15, verses 1 and 2, and we're not going to go there, but when you go there, they're singing a song of deliverance. They just got out of Egypt. The Lord has just crushed their enemies with the Red Sea, and they've gone through the Red Sea. And they're singing this great song of deliverance, okay? And then here, just a couple of chapters later, in chapter 32 is where my example is. I'm only going to pick and choose some verses, but we're going to start in verse 17. This is where Moses and Joshua go up on the mountain. Moses gets the Ten Commandments. 32:17 says, "And when Joshua heard the noise of the people as they shouted, he said unto Moses, there's a noise of war in the camp. And he said, it is not, and he said, talking about Moses, it is not the voice of them that shout for mastery, neither it is the voice of them that cry for being overcome, but the noise of them that sing do I hear. And it came to pass, as soon as they came nigh upon the camp, that he saw the calf and the dancing. And Moses' anger was waxed hot, and he set the tables out of his hands and brake them beneath the mount." Then it goes on to say in verse 21, it says, "And Moses said unto Aaron, what did this people unto thee that thou hast brought such great sin upon them?" And then in 25 it says, "And when Moses saw the people were naked, for Aaron had made them naked to the shame of their enemies." So just picking kind of those verses apart, it says that this noise, the noise of them that sang, do I hear, you know, to Joshua was a, and he, you got to remember, he's a general in the war. He's seen a lot of war. And this sounded like war to him. And he thought it was war. This noise was accompanied by dancing and nakedness. And don't miss in verse 21, it says it was a sin. Now, we really don't have time, but I'm real short. There is a place for dancing, okay, in your Bible. But the Bible doesn't put limitations on it. But if you read your Bible, you'll see the limitations that God places on it. Ecclesiastes 3:4 says there is a time to dance. But it's not like dancing to, you know, the bump and grind kind of dance. David danced toward the before the Lord in 2 Samuel 6:14. You know, he honored God. Miriam's dance in Exodus 15:20, you know, again is not a sensual kind of dance. It was all women, and they were playing the musical instruments, and they were dancing. Dancing's mentioned in Luke 15:25 when they're having a party for the prodigal son when he returns. It doesn't say whether that's good or bad. But there is a bad example of dancing, and that's in Mark 6:22-24, and that's the dancing of Herodias' daughter, where she was a dance of seduction, you know, where she was doing it for Herod and ended up in John the Baptist's head being cut off. Anyway, that's a little side note. But, you know, these people were worshiping a false god. If you read all those verses that are in there, you'll see that they were praying to a god that Aaron had fashioned out of gold, a calf. And they were partying, you know. I've seen this type of atmosphere before as a lost man when I went to concerts, okay. Everything except I didn't see the nakedness at the concert. But that might have been going on. I just never saw it. But, but that happens even today. There it is. Okay. I mean, and I'm not encouraging you to do it, but if you don't believe me, go to Woodstock and look at a bunch of pictures from Woodstock. And that was 1967 or 69. Yeah, 69, up in New York. And in there was rock and roll music, and there was a lot of dancing, and there was a lot of other stuff that went on. you look at the Burning Man festivals that are taking place every year in Nevada, okay, those are the ones that are in the news. If you look at some of those pictures, it's revolting too. It's not any worse than down south in Louisiana. Until God flooded them out, for a couple of years it was all right, but down there. But every year at Mardi Gras, they call it. I mean, it's the same thing. It's the same atmosphere, same music, the same, all the other things, and the nakedness that goes along with it. Bible says in 32, Exodus 32, 6, it says, and they arose up early on the morrow and offered burnt offerings and brought peace offerings, and the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. You know, and that's in all of us. And you know, just don't miss that, again, it's in verse 21, it calls it a sin. In verse 30 through 32, it's a great sin. And then in verse 25, it says, he made them naked and ashamed among the enemies of God. You know, so it gave God a black eye. All right, third example, and this is the one I really like the most, but we're running out of time. It's found in Daniel chapter 3. You find another musical band that was worshiping a false god. And it says, thou, king, hath made a decree that every man shall hear the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, dulcimer, and all kinds of music shall fall down and worship the golden image. And again, it's a golden image. You know, the Bible is, you know, trying to tell you something there. Because what they did in Exodus was a golden calf, and this is a golden image. But anyway, they worship in Moloch. Similarly, music was a big part of that. When they would throw, and I don't think anybody in here took my Old Testament survey, but if you did, you would have learned a lot about Moloch and how they, when they sacrificed the children to Moloch, was a big iron statue that they would heat up, and then they would throw the children in it alive, and they would burn up. Well, the way they did it was they played music. They played drums, and they played trumpets and stuff like that to drown out the cries of the children while the parents threw the children in there. Huh? Yeah. But it's, you know, it's anyway, that's an example. Let's see. Like I said, you know, this portion of Scripture, and that's what I would hope you would do as you read your Bible, as you personalize some of these examples about, and this, and the book of Daniel is great. There's three, and probably more, but there's three examples that I wrote down here real quick, and I'll give them to you. In chapter 1, you see the four Hebrew children standing against the government, whatever you want to call it, the ruler, Nebuchadnezzar, by not eating because they knew it wasn't right. Okay, that's one example. This is the second one in chapter 3 where you have the three Hebrew children that are saying, you can do what you want, king, but we're not going to bow. It's simple as that. And then the third example is Daniel by himself later on. I think that's chapter 6, if I remember right. And he's saying that you know, they wrote a law saying that you can't pray to any other gods but or make a petition of any other gods except the king. And what did Daniel do? Daniel went and threw the windows open, and he prayed just like he'd always done because that was the right thing to do. And those are examples of civil disobedience that I think that, you know, each person's got to come to on their own, but those are examples of the right way to do it. If it needs to be done, that's the correct way to do it. I mean, I have a lot more respect for Rosa Parks and people that went through that period of time that when they performed civil disobedience, they just took what happened. They didn't try to lie their way out of it or do something else. They just said, okay, I think this is right, so I'm going to take the consequences for it, regardless. They just, and that's the way we're supposed to be as Christians. We're supposed to just stand up for what is right, and then take the consequences for us. If you lose miss a promotion at work because of it, well, then so be it. Take it. You don't have to whine about it. You don't have to, you don't have to riot over it. Take the consequences for what you're doing and do it openly and make a clear line of why you're doing it. Have the Bible to back you up, of course. But, I have much more respect for, like I said, somebody like Rosa Parks or somebody that just did it, and instead of somebody that, looted or set fires to buildings and broke glass and turned over police cars and what have you. I mean, I got no respect for those people at all. Anyway. So, let's see. And I guess we're going to, I'll give you the last one and we'll stop. But, again, that was music being used evilly. Using it for pride, for all of those different things for that king. This last example is what Solomon did while he was dedicating the temple, and it's found in 2 Chronicles. 2 Chronicles 5, 12 through 14, it says, "And also the Levites were the singers of all of them, Asaph, Heman, Jephthah, and all their sons and their brethren, being arrayed in white linen, having cymbals and psalteries and harps, stood at the east end of the altar, and with them 120 priests sounding with trumpets. And it came to pass, as the trumpeters and the singers were all as one to make one sound to be heard in praising and thanking the Lord, and when they had lifted up their voices with trumpets and cymbals and the instruments of music, and praise the Lord, saying, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. That then the house was filled with the cloud, even the house of the Lord, so that the priest could not stand to minister by reason of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord had filled the house of God." So that's a good example of, what singing can be done. But again, it must be, like I said, be done decently and in order. 1 Corinthians 14:40, let all things be done decently in order. And then really just a little bit of other stuff. But thank y'all. We'll start at 10 minutes. Lord, I ask you to bless this time and bless this service in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
right. Good morning. Welcome to Anchor Baptist Church. Let's all stand and get our hymn books. We can sing hymn number 299, Day by Day. Hymn number 299. Let's stand and sing.
Day by day, and with each passing moment, strength I find to meet my trials here. Trusting in my Father's wise bestowments, I've no cause for worry or for fear. He whose heart is kind beyond all measure, He gives unto loving thee is paths of pain and pleasure, toil and toil with peace and rest.
Verse 2.
Every day the Lord Himself is near me, with a special mercy for each hour. All my cares He fain would bear and cheer me. He whose name is Counselor in Power, the protection of His child and treasure, He's a charge that on Himself He laid. As I gaze, Thy strength shall be in measure, this the pledge to me. Help me then in every tribulation, so to trust Thy promises, O Lord, that I lose not faith's sweet consolation offered me within Thy holy word. Help me, Lord, when toil and trouble meeting, where to take that's from a Father's hand. One by one, the days, the moments fleeting, till I reach the promised land.
All right, let's turn over to hymn number 398. Follow on. Hymn number 398.
In the valley with my Savior I would go, where the flowers are blooming and the sweet waters flow. Everywhere He leads me, I will follow, follow on, walking in His footsteps till the crown be won. Follow, follow, I will follow Jesus. Anywhere, everywhere, I would follow on. Follow, follow, I will follow Jesus. Everywhere He leads me, I will follow on. Down in the valley with my Savior I would go, where the storms are sweeping and the dark waters flow. With His hand to lead me, I will never, never fear. Danger cannot fright me when my Lord is near. Follow, follow, I will follow Jesus. Anywhere, everywhere, I will follow on. Follow, follow, I will follow Jesus. Everywhere He leads me, I will follow on. Down in the valley or upon the mountain steep, close beside my Savior, I would never keep. He will lead me safely in the path that He has trod, up to where they gather on the hills of God. Follow, follow, I will follow Jesus. Anywhere, everywhere, I will follow on. Follow, follow, I will follow Jesus. Everywhere He leads me, I will follow on.
All right, Brother Hanson.
How's everybody doing?
Great.
Most of you are wore out because you spent the week in 100 degree heat on
asphalt. How smart was that? But, you got to pick some fruit. And that's why you do it, isn't it? Okay, so there's a reward there. Yeah, I know. I couldn't understand. I could hear stuff. Chuck was talking in his Sunday school lesson about chameleon-type Christians, and it just so happened that on this day in this devotional that I read, it's called Chameleon Christians. And the scripture that he uses, 1 Kings 18:14, says, "And now thou sayest, go tell the Lord, behold, Elijah is here, and he shall slay me." When one mentions the name Henry Ford, how many of you have ever driven a Ford product? Okay. Hank was famous. It had to be a red Ford pickup. I told him to get the heated tailgate so when it broke down, your hand wouldn't be cold while you're pushing it. But anyway, it says Ford was responsible for the Ford Motor Company as well as giving the average American an opportunity to own one of his Model T motor cars. What many do not know about Ford was his alliance to Nazism and Adolf Hitler. On 31st July 1938, Ford was presented the Grand Cross of the Supreme Order of the German Eagle for his persuasive voice towards the Nazi cause. In the 1920s, Henry Ford was avowed anti-Semite, published and distributed a series of four pamphlets entitled The International Jew, The World's Problem, a letter written by Himmler in a 1924 article described Ford as a valuable and important Nazi. Interestingly, Ford is the only American given a favorable mention in Hitler's Mein Kampf. In 1 Kings 18, Obadiah is confronted with the prophet Elijah. Their conversation revealed a shifting alliance in Obadiah's heart between wicked King Ahab and God. Obadiah can be likened to the carnal Christian who makes alliances with people who have no use for God or the Bible, because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, and neither indeed can be. And Pastor and Chuck and Hank have all taught in Colossians, and we've all heard it. It all depends how you look at it. I got to make a living. Everybody else does it. We make excuses for not representing God. Henry Ford, a carnal Christian, is a chameleon, conforming and aligning himself to whom he is around. Ford was happy to enjoy the fame of being called a great American for his economic contributions, the love of money. And yet he openly admired and supported one of history's most horrific despots. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is peace. The ever-changing ideals of a carnal Christian lead one away from God, even as they lead to continuing conformity to the world's ideologies. A carnal Christian can renew his mind by surrender to God and transforming thoughts, transforming through God's word. Have you ever felt yourself trying to conform or chickening out a little bit? He stabbed me in the heart with that, and it happened to be today's reading. So it really just kind of stabbed me to death. Do you remember the Uvalde where they killed the kids in the school and the police didn't go in? And they had a pastor out there at a church. His name is Pastor Jimenez. And he was interviewed on Fox News, and he did nothing but glorify God and Jesus Christ. And they tried their hardest to get him off of the TV, but Fox carried him a little bit. So I wrote him a letter, and I think I sent him an offer, and I can't remember, but he mentions it. But he said, "Appreciate your generous donation and for the people of Uvalde tragedy." He was on nationwide television talking about Jesus Christ, and look what the Lord does to him. "We have been overwhelmed by the size of ministry and donations. We have deeply apologized for our response, delay in response. The funerals for these children and adults have been held in the ministry to the communities, continuing in various ministries. We assisted two families with providing for their salary due to loss of time from their employment. We also distributed much needed food for the families and extended families that came during the tragedy and funeral. Some of the citizens of Uvalde loaned out their motorhomes and travel trailers to house the population of incoming friends and family. We're continuing to provide assistance with some of the families, and will be forwarded some of your donations, First Baptist Church, to Del Rio Uvalde Baptist Association, blah, blah, blah. And the association office is located, and they tell you they would be in touch with the family as well and pressing needs. Anyway, I read that because I listened to the man on nationwide television, and he didn't talk about how great this is and how this. He lifted up Jesus Christ and said how everybody needed him. God answered the need, which he does all the time. So, Chuck today was teaching in Sunday school about the Bible, and he was teaching about music. In Second Chronicles, it tells you, if you're talented in music, you're supposed to do music. If you're talented in cutting grass, you're supposed to cut grass. If you're talented in teaching, use your talents. Recognize what your talents are and use them. So that was just when I was in high school. I know it seems like a century ago. It almost is. But we opened the school. The morning session, your homeroom session, was with prayer and a scripture reading. That's out the window now. Wonder why things are a little different in school. Wonder why you homeschool people. Okay? All right. Anyway, who was... participated in Vacation Bible School today? I mean, this week. I thank you. You guys slaved, worked. They jumped all over me because I came up here. I could barely walk, and it was 100 degrees, and they're out there dying on the pavement. Oh, you show up. No, just for a moment. But I know that you people suffered up here, and the rewards. I mean, you've got a reward, whether you see it or not. Bella Wheeler, got saved. She's not here today, but we wish that she was. And then I understand that your granddaughter had some questions, and I'm sure that your wife is going to counsel with her and try and bring her along. All right, pray for Billy Clark, because they're on vacation. And 3-4 weeks back, Ursula asked us to pray for Betty Croyle. She went home to be, I don't know if she's saved or not. She passed away yesterday. So keep that family in prayer. And if you have not looked at your email, or you don't have access to email, it'll be up on the board soon enough. Brother Hunter sent a real lengthy missionary letter back on the email, kind of depicting all the things he's done. He's been busy over there, and it's good. Big prayer request coming up, August 22nd. Elise is going to have surgery at Georgetown Hospital, and it's because she's been persistent, and a lot of prayer has been going out, and, you know, just because we put too much emphasis on science, and yes, science is important. It's a foundation of a lot of things, but one of the things she learned through her persistence is, and one of the things you need to be careful of when you go to the doctor, it's all on the American Medical Association sheet with all the little check marks, code this, code that. Check the wrong box and you won't get treated. So if somebody, the scribe, doctors all have scribes now, don't check the right box. You may not get treated. So, but through her diligence, prayer and everything else, and not giving up, don't quit. It got done. So August 22nd, she'll be at Georgetown Hospital having surgery. So keep that in mind and pray for her. All right, put it on your prayer list to pray that morning. And hold it, pray for the doctors and everything. August 14th, we're going to have choir practice at 2 p.m. And on the 21st, Samson Ryman will be preaching here at Anchor. All right, and then there'll be street preaching 2:30 to 3:30 at the courthouse. August 21st through the 28th is the revival at Ryman's, and the 28th through September 2nd is the revival here for Mark McGahey and the Doucettes. So, does anything else we need to mention about that? Yes, ma'am. With, all right, they got the bug or the crud. All right, yes, sir. Not smacking you. Wonder if she's got an arm left living in you. All right, good. It's good to see you. Does anybody have anything else? Good to have you back. Yes, sir.
Partially, he was homesick. He had issues at the end, but he did cut my trip 2 days short, which probably was a blessing in disguise. He was fine. I thank you for all your prayers. Today I finished class number 11. Basically, my schoolwork is done for that class. And I have one more class, and I will have completed a master's in accounting.
Going into business? Going to start a new business?
No. It's all. And I do have one prayer request. My neighbor, Miss Pickett, who does pray for this church, she fell while I was away. She had surgery on her pelvis and been put in because it was a bad fracture. And she's in
okay. Giuseppe? Okay. All righty. Being that this church has gone to the dogs, literally, all you have to do is go back in there. My dog has a tumor. We aspirated it, and the sample wasn't good enough, so now I have to take her back. And I like for my dog not to have a tumor. I mean, a cancer. Yes, ma'am.
Just want to thank God for the last 3 weeks. Really, God has blessed.
We missed you.
Thank you.
It's stage fright. That's what it was, wasn't it? Anxiety. How did Pennsylvania go? Turn the place out. Amen. Amen. What was the pastor's name?
They call him Pastor Polk. But I forget his
name. Polk?
Yeah, I forget his real name, but they call him Pastor Polk. He's just really, you know, we got a really good message. We got to go out and speak with him. The kids love
him. Tomorrow I'm going to drive down and drive back to North Carolina, and it's just because I want to be with my son, but he's down there going to be practicing his car at North Wilkesboro. But at the end of the month, I'm going to be out of here for probably 2 to 3 weeks, and we're going to have Sherry Goodman Hyde here watching our dog in the house, and if y'all could just pray for her, travel mercy. She's coming up on the 22nd. And we'll go down to see Tom Flaherty. I think he's diminishing kind of quickly. Keep him in prayer. Faithful member here for many, many years. Was a great organizer, great chairman of trustees, and just an all-around good guy. Had a lot of fun with him over the years, and Chris and I have stopped to visit with them last time we went south, and what's the worst thing that's going to happen to him? He's going to wake up and see Jesus. So if that's the worst thing. Yeah. All right. Does anybody have anything else? It's good. It's been a crazy, crazy couple weeks. We had sickness run through this place. We've had people traveling. And they're sick. The people sick today. Families are going on vacation. You're supposed to take a little rest every now and then. I'm glad they're doing it. And just keep things in prayer. Young lady right there said she had a good time in Vacation Bible School, didn't you? Yeah. So I'm glad you guys are back safe. We didn't see your husband one day while you were going. Not once did he show up. I ratted you out, brother. While I did that, why don't you get up and pray for all the stuff we've just asked for? We want prayer for surgery, prayer for the sick people, prayer for the offering and the pastor's message. He's not going to be able to hear you. He's got sinus so bad he can't hear. Doesn't affect his mouth. That'll be running when they put him in the box. So.
Jesus, the new word, that we died for you to free, and you faith with the Son of the Lord, in your precious name, amen, amen.
All right, let's stand and sing. Get a hymn book, so you can sing hymn number 272, The Solid Rock, hymn number 272. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness veils his lovely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor folds within the veil. On Christ's solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. His oath, his covenant, his blood, sir, pour me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, he then is all my hope and stay. On Christ's solid, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found. Dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ's solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. All right, let's have my family come up and sing.
No matter what. I sought the Lord, and He answered me and delivered me from every fear. Those who look on Him are radiant. They'll never be ashamed. They'll never be ashamed. This poor man cried. Save me from my enemies. The Son of God surrounds His saints. He will deliver them. He will deliver them. The Lord is good. Oh, blessed is He,
who hides in Him.
Oh, fear the Lord. Oh, all you saints, He'll give you what you need. He'll give you what you need. Magnify the Lord with me. Come exalt His name together. Glorify the Lord with me. Come exalt His name forever. Bless the Lord every day and night, never ending praise. May our incense rise. Let us bless the Lord. Bless the Lord.
taste and see that the Lord is good. He'll give you what you need. He'll give you what you need.
There's no more specials. Can we have Pastor come up? Oh, we have another special?
So it was a blessing that my favorite part of every evening was when we get up and we would sing two songs, Hallelujah, Hallelujah, and I've got joy, and man, it was so loud in here. And it was a blessing to see all the kids just singing and just happy. Everybody was happy to participate. I want to thank all the people who were involved as a parent for the kids who were in here. They had a great time. They enjoyed their week, so thank you very much for taking the time out of your lives to invest in the children.
And I want to real quick, because I know some people couldn't be here today, so hopefully you're watching, but we had quite a lot of kids show up, and everyone just jumped in, and kids were going home and bringing their friends back because they were hearing how much fun they were having, and that wouldn't be possible without everybody working together as a team, and I appreciate you guys so much. It went so smooth, and it was another hit this year, so thank you, everybody, and everyone watching. Thank you guys so much for all your hard work. And I love you guys. You guys rock. And just the smiles on the faces and that little girl getting saved, like I would do it next week in a heartbeat all over again. And Adriana asking questions like that, just special place in my heart. So kids and my little cousin right here, so she got to come be part of it, so I just loved it. So.
All right, sing loud. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.
Praise ye the Lord.
Praise ye the Lord.
Hallelujah.
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 All right, sing loud. All right, we're going to enjoy. I've got joy down in my heart,
deep down in my heart.
J-O-Y down in my heart,
deep down in my heart.
Jesus put it there, and nothing can destroy it. Ooh. I've got joy down in my heart,
deep down in my heart.
We're going to do one really fast one, okay? I've got joy down in my heart,
deep down in my heart.
J-O-Y down in my heart, deep down in my heart. Jesus put it there, and nothing can destroy it. I've got joy in my heart, deep down in my heart. All right, get up there.
Amen. Amen.
Well, I'm glad you're here. Hello?
Am I on? Oh, I'm on.
Scared the fire out of me. I'm glad for a mic because I don't have much voice. And believe me, mine's not COVID. Every time somebody sneezes, you got COVID. Well, what a way to get out of here. No, I don't have COVID. I have tremendous problems with sinuses. And I want to thank the Lord that I was able to come at least a few nights of that. But I started to feel bad, and I wanted to make sure that wasn't anything. And then my back started acting up, which, you know, if you're get to a certain age. Chuck Chuck knows what I'm talking about. Most of the time, I did rod reinforcement work for a number of years in cables, in construction. And I wasn't the kind of boss that, I wasn't like, keep the drawings and stand over, you do this, you do this, you do that, you do this. I couldn't do it. It just made the day, like an 8-hour day, like 16 hours. So I'd take my pusher, which is like an assistant foreman, I'd give him the drawing, say, you mark it out, I'm going to go help him put it in. And that way I knew it was put in the way I wanted it to put in. Donnie probably can acknowledge that. And a lot of times he has to work side by side with him, and I'm paying a price in my back for it. But thank God I'm at my age still able to stand and talk about him. And that's what I want to talk about a little bit this morning. Look at I picked up the wrong sermon. I want to go to Genesis anyway, so I know where I want to go. Genesis chapter 22, and I'll save this for you for maybe another time. But there are people that are, I guess, homesick, home not feeling good, home tired, home wore out. People are away. Pray for Ben and them that God will give them some good family time together. I think that's good. Always happy to see the Smoots back. Amen. Triple happy that I was trying to give Wade a visitor's card. I asked him who he was, and he said, I'm backsliding. Do you have any money for me? No, he didn't. But Genesis chapter 22, I'm only going to read a few verses of it. I think you know the story here about, what did I do now? Did I forget something? I just put Wade out there on the burner. Where's your guitar at? In the back? Somewhere in the back? Oh, it's backsliding, and you're trying to get it right to come up, right? But I wasn't immensely proud of just one individual. I want to acknowledge and thank the Lord Jesus Christ for my daughter's persistence, not in the youth rally, but when they diagnosed what she had many years ago, rightfully, I could have sued the doctor. He misdiagnosed her, which has caused her, since she was 17 years of age, a lot of pain, a lot of misery, a lot of hard work. When they turned her down this time, and I thought, well, you know, you tried, and she said, no, this is right, they're wrong, and I'm going to, and then thank you for praying for her, because she stuck by it, and God, she said, Lord, you know I'm right, and it come back, and there was a mediator committee, and they said, no, this is medical, this needs to be taken care of. And they went against the insurance company and told them, you will take care of that young lady. Thank you for your prayers. And I wished I had the persistence that she has when it comes to the Lord. But here's a great thing that you find here. And you find Abraham. And if you understand the story in Genesis chapter 22, I teach or preach on this thought, God doesn't want your Isaac. You know what God really wants out of you and out of me? To have faith in him. And at times we sense that we look at the object, look at the situation, look at things, and we look at those things and we say, well, I don't know how that's going to happen. Well, I know a God. I have a personal relationship with him. In fact, I'm in him and he's in me. Do you understand that? I know who I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I committed unto him against that day. Do you understand who I'm talking about? If you understand, you might open your mouth and say, yeah, I know him. You know him this morning? Have there ever been a time when you bowed your head and asked the Lord Jesus Christ to save you? September the 21st, 1975, about 12:15 in the morning or the afternoon, I bowed my head and asked the Lord Jesus Christ to save me. And buddy, it's been a roller coaster ride. But you know what? He never left me. I've left him a few times, and he said, boy, you better come home. But here's a story about Abraham, and you understand when he says, God comes to Abraham, and he says, take thy son. Now, listen to the language of this thing. Thy only son. Did he say that, brother? Didn't he have two boys there? Only one God recognized was the one that God told him to have. And he gets in there and he says this. Look, Genesis 22, and look at this. And it came to pass after these things, verse 1, that God did tempt Abraham. And he said unto Abraham, he said, behold, here am I. And he said, take now thy son, thine only son, Isaac. Well, Abraham had two sons, but God didn't recognize that one because God didn't set it up that way, did he? You know who God the Father has what? One son. His name is Jesus Christ. You see what I'm seeing here? There's only one that was recognized. But you go through this thing, and for time's sake, I'm not going to make you stand all morning, maybe another 30 minutes, but when you look at this thing, and he said, take now thy son, thine only son, Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains which I will tell thee of. And Abraham rose up early in the morning and saddled his ass and took two of his young men with him, and Isaac his son, and claved the wood for the burnt offering, and rose up and went unto a place which God had told him. And on the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place afar off. So God had showed him something here. Verse 5, Abraham said unto his young men, abide ye here with the ass. I and the lad will go yonder and worship and come again. You know what the Lord just told him? He's taken him and he said, I'm going to send him up as a type of Jesus Christ, his only son. It's a type of the sacrifice that's getting ready to be made for you and I, that we might have life, have it more abundantly, right? Amen. And so you get this thing, but he makes a statement, and he tells them that they will be back. So he has faith in his God. Excuse me. He has faith in his God that God's going to do what he said. He gave him that boy. He's going to keep him with that boy. And you know what? They built an altar. An altar is a place where you and I can meet with God. An altar is a place where something that goes there never comes back the same way. An altar is a place that something has to die in order for something to come out and live. Amen? Father, we love you. Pray you'll bless the message. In Jesus' name, you may be seated. Now, so you get into this thing, and it's a great story, and it's a marvelous story about Abraham and about his faith. And that's what I look at when I preach about that. But I don't want to preach about that this morning. Years ago, and my wife and I had this conversation this morning. She said, haven't you preached that sermon? And I looked, and I want to thank, I'm sure Billy and him might be trying to tap in and watch, but I looked. And I saw that because of the schedule he had laid out for me, which helps me immensely, because I don't want to give you the same message every 2 weeks or 4 weeks or 6 weeks. So I looked at that thing, and I hadn't preached this thing in over 3 years. I've talked about it, but never really preached it again. And it's been a lot of years since I had. And the Lord kept impressing me, I think there's some things going on, and not in Anchor Baptist Church, but there's things that are going on in the body of Christ around the world. And you know what it is? Years ago, I took a little church, my first church I ever took. I turned down a much larger church, a much more established church. I turned it down, and Serena and I, we prayed about it. Brother Ron, I went into this church. Honey, tell me the name of that place over there again. Zor Baptist Church. And I went over there, and they had Wade, I'm telling you what, they had plank floors down there that they were like that. I mean, that place was immaculate, was beautiful. I mean, I want to say they had the graveyard outside, but a lot of it was still inside. Just like right now, you're able to smile, you really can go. But I went into that place, and I went in with a message. And I sat down with the Lord. I hadn't been out of Bible school very long, and I sat down with the Lord, and I said, Lord, what in the world am I going to preach to that church up there? My name was given by a man that I knew pretty well. I bought a car from. He was in the car business, and he was one of the people that had put my name in the hat up there, said they're really looking for a pastor, and I'm recommending you. And so they called me, and I went up there. I met with them, and I had this big old farmer, Wade. This old boy, he's sitting there with his broke hands on, and you know how they look. Look like they hadn't gotten away from the dinner table in 4 or 5 weeks. I mean, you could tell he was a worker. You shake his hands like sandpaper. I mean, get everything off yours, amen. It just tough guy. And he looks over at me, and this guy's giving me a hard time. I mean, he's just like, what do you think this, and you think that, and you think this? And I said, I think what the Bible says. And he says, well, what do you mean what the Bible says? Well, what about a woman? Can she be a deacon? I said, well, if she can be a man at the same time, she can be a deacon. And he got angry. Well, I didn't lie, did I? Did I not tell him if a man desire the offer of a bishop, amen, the bishop and his qualifications are one and the same. And the guy looks over. You know what the guy ended up saying? This one guy, his wife ended up being the deaconess of the church. I didn't know it. I didn't care. I was up there because they called me. I didn't call them. You say, well, I'm satisfied wherever God puts me. And so this thing got on up there, and this old boy, he just kept sticking a needle in my side, kept sticking a needle. And that big old farmer stood up and said, we call this preacher up here to run him through the ringer or to bring him up to the church to preach for us tomorrow. As a matter of fact, I'm getting tired of hearing it. I want the boy to come up and preach, so y'all better vote. I thought, good night. I don't know if he scared them. He scared me. I said, yeah, I'll come. I went up there, and I did preach. And the Lord laid on me something that I probably was going around the corner to tell you something, but the Lord laid on me something that I couldn't get away from. And it's like this. There's certain things that the Lord gives you, and you just can't get away from it. And it's been all week long. I can't get away from it. You say, what was it? It's called the compromising Christian. I'm not going to preach that this morning. But a lot of times going on in Christianity, we will compromise our beliefs in order to get what we want, not really what God wants for us. And I wasn't about to go in there, Brother Ron, under the wrong impression that I was willing to compromise to another Bible. There's only one book. That's the KJV. I wasn't about to go in there, Jim, and compromise that you will tell me what to teach and what to preach and God won't. No, I'm not about to do that. That is not in my way of thinking. And the Lord gave me that thing at over there in Genesis where they tried to get Moses to compromise. And I just couldn't do it. So I preached on that thought, the compromising Christian. And I wanted to tell you this, that they ended up about 6-8 weeks. I hadn't heard from them. And I just said, well, okay, this other church wants me to take it. I'm going to take it. And it wasn't even close to the same structure of a church. Am I right? I mean, the one church had maybe 150, I don't know. It had quite a few people in there. Beautiful facility. They had the computerized thing where you punch in certain things in the computer and the chimes would play. I'm like, stand at the door, preacher, and shake everybody's hand. Time I got tired, my arm was wore out. But I say all that to say this, that the best thing you and I can do is there some things that we should pray about. We take it that if it's prosperous to us, it's God, and it isn't. It's not always God. God sometimes will put you through the test. He will take and see whether you really are real or not real. I look around this morning and see a bunch of folks not here. I'm not going to complain about that, gripe about that. That's between them and God. If they should be here and aren't here, that's on them, not on me. But what I want to tell you this morning is what I've noticed over the years and what I noticed at that place there, what I've noticed when even at the smaller church that I ended up taking, I look down. You notice right here there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You know the Bible, in the Bible, the number 5 is based for? You know what an altar is about? Something has to die, Brother Ron, and for others, something to give life. Jesus Christ died that we might have life and might have it more abundantly. You understand that? I have life not because of me, Don. I have life because someone gave me life. His name is Jesus Christ. Amen. He became sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. And so when I think about that thing, I think about, here's an altar in Genesis chapter 22. They made an altar. Why? Because he had to die in order for you and I to have life. And that's the picture that it's showing. And so I started to think about this. And so some time ago, I've got to tell you how old this thing is. 2001. So we're talking about, what, 21 years ago? The Lord gave me this message. And I've been trying all week, Lord, I don't want to preach it. And the Lord says, okay, I ain't going to give you anything else, so you preach what you want. And so I'm going to preach to you on the thought, some things that you will find at an altar. You see, a lot of people think an altar is, well, you got to come down here and display all this and make yourself known. No, that's not it. You have an altar at your home. Is there a place where you pray at? Is there a place where you and God get along? Is there a place where you and God deal with each about situations in your life? I have a place in there. I find my little place that I go to. You say, where is it? That's not her business, anybody else's business, but me and God's. And I'll go find that place, and I'll get alone with God and say, Lord, we got to talk. And the Lord said, I've been waiting on you. You ever had that happen to you? An altar, if you notice, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, is where you die to self so God can deal with you. You're going to have to die to yourself. I didn't say physically die. I said you're going to have to die to your way of thinking, your way of doing things, your way of going and doing what you think is right and what you think is wrong. Because God says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no man cometh to the Father but by me. You want to get to God? You're going to have to go through Jesus Christ. You want to get to live where he lives at? You're going to have to go through. He's the way. Why? Because he became sin for us who knew no sin. So I want to give you about 400 of these things. But number one, I want to say I found a conversion for my soul. I went to a camp meeting or a youth meeting. Alan Ryman and I have been talking about them and talking about them, and we're talking about starting one back up closer. It's nothing against the one in West Virginia. It's not a kicking at that, but it's just, it makes it easier on the preachers to run over there, get back. It makes it easier on the people rather than drive 7.5 hours. You realize that's 15 hours round trip. Amen. And I don't know about you, but I think we could get more people here to go if we were closer. It's all about helping them get closer to God. And so I was there, and Steve Irie and I were standing over there, and I watched these children, Sister Julie. I watched how children just came up, and they were crying and hugging each other. And I watched as they got down the altar, or they got a young man or a young lady, and they got down to the altar. And when they got down there, all of a sudden you heard them cry, Wahoo! glory to God. Somebody just got saved. You say, that's charismatic, that's crazy. No, that's God. I'm sorry, but that's God. That's how God does things. God, he said, I come to seek and to... I wonder why people aren't talking about salvation anymore. You see, I found conversion for my soul. My condition. You know what? Before you can ever get saved, you got to get lost. I said before you can ever get saved, you're going to have to get lost. The ones in the back, all the way back there, are sitting. I'm just kidding. But look, before anybody can get saved, you've got to realize and recognize you're lost as without Jesus Christ, without hope and without God, period. Say, I've never been saved. Then you need to get saved. Amen. You say, well, I'm hiding it. I don't think I like the way you're talking about it. It doesn't matter what you're hiding. It doesn't matter. There's a reason why it bothers you. I'm going to tell you what, if I tell Steve, you know, you got to get saved, you're going to have, before you ever go to heaven, you're going to have to trust him. Does it bother you? No, I don't. Why? Because he's one of his, he's in him, and him. Boy, I'm telling you what, it's just good. I didn't think I had this much voice, but I hope I'm irritating somebody. But the deal of it is, you're going to have to understand that, listen, that was the day I found conversion for my soul is the day I took and quit putting my trust in me and put it in him. The day I'm going to quit trying to work on my good works and I'm for by grace are you saved. Do you understand that? By what? And that is not of yourselves. It is a, and not of, lest any man should. Isn't that an amazing thing? I can, people say, well, what do you got to do to get it? Just take it. I stood up here one time and I pulled out a $100 bill. I don't have any more. I'm married. I don't even have $2 bills. But I stood up here one time and said, I had a $100 bill. I said, if I offered you $100, would you take it? I couldn't even get it out. People started running. I said, well, you ain't getting my $100 bill. Put it back in my pocket. I figured I better pull out a dollar the next time. But, you know, people said, yeah, I'll take it. I ain't crazy. I ain't a fool. Why would you pass up a free gift of salvation? Well, that's what you said. No, that's what he said. I am the way. Either he's, I say this reverently, either Jesus Christ lied, he's egotistical, or he's telling you the truth. I'd say he's telling you the truth. Behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. Who were they talking to? Jesus Christ. What was his motive for coming? You see, the day I hit my altar, and the altar is a place where you die to yourself and you start looking under him, the author and finisher of your faith. You understand the day that you did that, that's the day that you and God could get on level ground and start dealing with the fact that you're lost without hope and without God. And I looked at these children as they went up there, and I'd hear this, glory to God. And I thought, that's what he did for me. You see, that beautiful day of September the 21st, 1975, at a little old non-denominational church, I hit the altar and bowed my head and said, Lord, I'm not one of yours. I'm going to die and I'm going to go to hell. And he looked at me and he said, you don't have to. I died for your sins. They're already in hell paid for if you'll just take me. Oh boy, never heard such great news. Never heard anything any better. I reached down and I said, oh Lord, are you kidding me? That's the greatest deal I've ever heard. And I took him. You say, what about now? Well, it's been a lot of years. You can do the math. I'm getting up now on almost 50 years of being saved. I've not done right every way, but I know I'm saved. Why? Grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you're sealed unto the day of redemption. People say, well, you can lose it. You lose yours. I can't. I'm in him and he's in me. You lose that. You figure that one out and we'll talk about it. You can't lose your salvation. You didn't do anything to get it. And Jesus Christ either told the truth or he lied. And I'll bank on him before I bank on anybody else. Amen. You got it? I found a conversion for my soul. I found compassion. Hebrews 4:15, for we know not on a high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities. You know what an altar is good for, Brother Ron? A lot of people, you go down there and say, see, look at them. They're getting what they deserve. The Lord says, I love you. You're my child. I'll have compassion on you. Man is a very judgmental individual. Hey, well, look at Wade. Look, I love Wade. But I can't love him as much as Jesus Christ did. I know most, well, I should know everybody in the church. But there's a lot of people, sometimes pride will keep you from coming down and talking with him. Told you a buddy of mine who led me was really instrumental in me getting saved. I told you about this guy. His name's Larry Whitaker. And Larry's still living. He's in a church in North Carolina trying to serve God. And we went through so many things. You know the thing, and I know it had to come from a saved woman with compassion in her heart, and I knew who put that compassion in there. His name is Jesus Christ. All the trouble, Brother Ron, I put that poor lady through, the heartaches, the many times I brought her husband, dropped him off at the house, and he was in bad shape. And that lady looked at me and said, Bob, please get saved. I don't want you to die and go to hell. Man, what in the world did you do that for? She said, cool. The Lord did it for me, and I wasn't as great, and he had compassion on me. I should have compassion on you. I found compassion. You see, he calls, he cares, he cries out to us. Come unto me, all you that labor and heavy laden, I'll give you rest. Come on. You want peace? You got problems? I'll give you rest. You don't understand situations and why you're going through this? Come on. We serve a compassionate God. I found that day. And there are times when I looked around, when you go through things and you say you're not supposed to go. I hear it. But you know what? I still bleed. I still care. I still cry. But he never leaves me. You say, what's it about? Well, it's that place where me and God meet at. You have that place? You ever been to that place where you and God? It ought to be a daily place. Amen. It ought to be a place where it's just you and God. Nobody else can enter into that place. The Bible says in the book of Mark, Jesus Christ himself prayed a great while before day. There's a place he went to. There ought to be a place you go to. Just you and God and say, Lord, let's talk this over. I'm going through this. I'm going through that. Lord, I need you. You say, well, I don't want people to see me come to the altar. Why? Are you afraid to show them that you love God and you're coming to the one? I tell you what, when God speaks to me, Don, I'm ready to move. I don't want to play no games. I don't want to know what I'm getting ready to go. I do not want to deal with God. Lord, you tell me, get down there, I'm getting. They had all that fancy music. They had everything going for them. Wade, where was God? They couldn't understand me taking that little old rinky-dinky church over there with 18 people wasn't about the people. I wanted to deal with some people that wanted to hear from God. And you can't really know God till you spend some time with him. People say, well, I believe in prosperity. I believe that God shall supply all your needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Didn't say he's going to give you what you want all the time. Isaac and I have been praying about a job for the right decisions. I talk with him every time I get to see him, and he finally landed the one God wanted him to have, and I'm so happy because he could have went this way, he could have went that way, but there's something about waiting on God and just praying and getting that little spot between you and God is a great lesson to be learned in that. I found the compassion of my Savior. Well, I found cleansing for my sins. And 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sin. And what? And what? Do you think there's a difference? Now, I'm not real great on the vocabulary or the day. Jim, is there a difference between cleaning and cleansing? I think there is. My wife tells me, you clean, I cleanse. Excuse me. I think that he says he'll cleanse them. And when I finish my job and she finishes hers, I go, okay, smarty, what'd you do? She said, I put more effort in it. The blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses us. Well, I think you can say, from, now, would you explain to me, you Bible correctors, would you explain to me, please, what all means? All means all, doesn't it? The deal of it is, my brethren, is there is a place where you can walk away spick and span clean. And all he's telling you is to come. All he's telling you is forget the pride. Forget what people think. Forget what people say. They don't talk about you behind your back anyway. They need to go get their heart right. But you go find a spot, that place you and God meet. It doesn't have to be here. It doesn't have to be at the church. I'm not looking for people to hit the altar. I'm looking for people to get their hearts right. And when you start doing that, excuse me, it's stuff's flowing in me. I found calmness in the storms of my life. I say this when Jim was talking about Tom Flaherty. About that same time, the first time Tom had went through that situation, and you'd have to meet Tom and Sandy Flaherty, just awesome, great people. Tom told him, you can't scare me with cancer. I'm saved. I know who I am, believed. You weren't going to budge that old boy. He was by the book and went straight down by the book. I tell you something Tom could do, and a lot of people can't. I watched Tom Flaherty get rebuked, pretty scathing rebuked. I didn't do it. Turn thing. I watched him do it, and I waited to see his reaction. And not a lot of people know about this, didn't say anything about it. He came to me with it, and we talked about it. And I wanted to see how he would react to it. You know what he did? And rather allowing him to draw him and put a gap between him and that individual, or put a gap in, he surveyed it, Sister Julie. He looked at it. He said, I went to God with this, and God says what they were saying was true. And if it's showing something that's stopping me from getting closer to him, I don't want that. I am going, regardless of my position, I'm a Christian first, and I need to stand and do that. That's the kind of man that guy is. He might be sickly, might be down, but you ain't going to scare him with heaven. Amen. Amen. pray for his precious wife. I saw one other thing in there. I found cheerfulness for my service. You see, a lot of people serve God so other people can see it. I serve God because I love him. Because he served me when nobody else cared about me. He died for me and looked for me and there for me. And in the wee hours when you can't talk to anybody else, even my wife, things that are going through me, he's there for me. And the storms and the problems, and he puts cheerfulness back in serving him. Buddy Cargill said one time he had, we have been blessed over the years, and we have more people than this, but the point of it is that Buddy never, I don't think, ever got larger than 30 people, 35, 40 people in his ministry. And Buddy went to the Lord one time and said something, and the Lord says, wouldn't you rather have a three-ring circus than a Barnum and Bailey circus where everybody does what they want to do? Be satisfied with what I give you. Cheerful. And are you happy about serving God? Amen? When you go down and you start laying your problems down, the Lord says, yeah, but you're saved. Yeah, but you're going to live with me one day. Yeah, but where I'm at, there's streets of gold. You might think it's worth it down here, but wait till you get there. If this earth's worth more to you than heaven is, something's wrong. Amen? And I'm going to have to stop because my throat won't quit itching, but I found a compass for direction, where to go, what to do, how to do it. Those are things that you and I can find at that place where we get down before God. Don't ask everybody around you, well, what do you think? What do you think? That's good. Hey, brother, pray for me. And get down on your face before God. Find your little altar spot and get there and get down there. Those kids were running back and forth, and some of them coming back crying and waving their hands. I got saved. I got something from God. He showed me what to do. I prayed for my mama and daddy, and he assured me that they were going to get saved. And ended up, after 2 or 3 or 4 weeks, getting calls back. Ryman would say those kids went home with the joy of the Lord in their heart and led their mom and daddy to the Lord. I'm telling you, brethren. But you know what you need? You need to find strength to keep on keeping on. You hear me? You ever get down? Lord, the load. The load's heavy. The Lord says, well, I gave you the Spirit of God that dwells in you. He'll lift you up a little bit. But he said, you know what I did? I had somebody help me with the cross, so I'll be there to help you with yours. Because I said I'd never leave you. He said I'd never forsake you. Yea, I will be with you always. In the time that you say, what? In the time trying to serve God, you think you're not going to have opposition? You better believe you are. But be of good cheer. I've overcome. God's laid you a trail. You know what? When the Southern Baptist Society said an altar should be banned out of every church, they were telling them, you don't need to talk with God. We don't bring you here to survey your heart. We bring you here to cheer you up. Can two walk together except they agree? You know what? Nothing between my Lord and my Savior. You understand? Stay tight with him. You say, what do you think? I think when you get home, wherever you want, you do it here, you do it home, do wherever you want. Just get in that spot between you and God and talk to him. You know, God's jealous, Brother Ryan. I can't figure it out. Why? He wants to talk with me. He said, but many as received me, to him gave he power to become the sons of God. Abraham took Isaac, and he had enough faith that his God was not going to take that which was lovely and special to him, but he was willing to take the test. You need to go to God. If it hasn't, you haven't been using that place, going to that place, surveying it, and you say, well, I don't understand this. You hadn't talked to God, have you? Because God is not the author of confusion. God doesn't try to deal you and confuse you with things. God wants you to have a relationship with you. Why? Because he died for you. Religion won't get you anywhere. Salvation will take you to glory one day. Father, we love you and we thank you, God, for your goodness. Thank you, Lord, for your mercy, for your grace, for the blessings of life. Lord, we're so grateful for a God who loves us and cares about us every day. You didn't leave us. You said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. You put a Holy Spirit of God that dwells inside of us that we might know that we have life and have it more abundantly. And I pray now that you'll bless in the time of this time for us to come and to just maybe get right with thee, get things taken care of with you, for the opportunity to pray, for the opportunity to talk with you, for God who cares about us. And we're grateful for it in Jesus' name. If you need to come and pray this morning, you come. If
hymn number 381.
You have longed for sweet peace and for faith to increase, and have earnestly, fervently prayed. But you cannot have rest or be perfectly blessed until all on the altar is laid. Is your all on the altar of sacrifice laid? Your heart does the Spirit control? You can only be blessed and have peace and sweet rest as you yield him your body and soul. Would you walk with the Lord in the light of his word and have peace and contentment always? You must do his sweet will to be free from all ill, and on the altar your all you must lay. Is your all on the altar